tonight. We are lucky enough to have a great presentation here. And it's being presented by Lieutenant Mark Lauer of the Vermont State Police. He's been with the State Police for 26 years. He's also a board member, and correct me if I'm wrong on this, the Vermont State Police Archive Center and Museum. They became a nonprofit 501c3 in 2009. And word is they've been collecting and gathering these archives since 2007. But Mark said there's some other hoarders involved that have been collecting it long before that. So we're going to welcome Mark in a minute. I have a couple of things. Always we want to thank our generous sponsors. We have a group of society sponsors this year. Tim Brisson and Northeast Planning Associates. Sear Lumber, who's new sponsor this year. Long Trail Physical Therapy, Mansfield HealthLight, Milton Diner, Pratt Contracting, Gil and Joan Rugg, another new sponsor for us this year, and Sampler House. And then our series sponsors are the Arrowhead Eagles, number 4218, Building Home Center, Century 21 Jack Associates, Don Turner, and the Hometown Team, R.R. Charlie Boys Incorporated, and L.D. Oliver C. And another wonderful announcement that we're so excited about is this week is the debut of the book Images of America, Milton. So this was a book that was done by Gary Furlong with the help of some of his students. And it is all the proceeds for books sold through the Historical Society benefit the Historical Society. I have a lot of books with me tonight if anyone's interested in buying them. We have them, the retail price is $21.99. And so it's a great book. I read it on Saturday and David was trying to get me to do stuff with them. I said, not till I finish this book. So Mark, I'll turn it over to you.
Well, I appreciate everybody coming out on a beautiful Wednesday evening. There's a lot of things I could be doing on this kind of evening and weather, but so I appreciate the fact that you all came out. A couple things I'd like to point out to you. Around the room, in addition to all of the memorabilia from the Milton Historical Society, there's also items that the center has brought in for you to look at. There's some jackets, there's an original Ike jacket here, a motor vehicle hat that the motorcycle patrol officers used to wear. There's a uniform in the back of the room that's on a mannequin, posters and pictures. So I'd like to just invite you to take the time after the presentation to wander around and look at these items. There's also a couple of yearbooks in the back of the room. One of the other things that I want to point out to you too, this is a work in progress. Let me back this thing up for a second. This is a work in progress. The opportunity to come out and do a presentation like this evening is one of the first times that we're actually getting out and actually speaking to a group like this, or at least myself. So the last week I've been compiling all this information. What I would tell you is if an opportunity arises for you to come and see another presentation, just don't think because you saw this when you saw all of it. I'm going to continue to work on this presentation and build it, and the next time you see it, there'll be more information, more details, things like that. So in addition to the presentation, I'll interject some pieces of information that aren't on the slideshow. And if you have any questions about anything about the State Police, whether it's past or present, I'll be happy to answer those if I have the information. Okay? Very informal. So this is a historical perspective of the State Police. Prior to 1947, all the law enforcement in the state of Vermont was handled at the local level, whether it was a local police department or a sheriff's department. There was no overarching law enforcement agency for the entire state. There were numerous attempts. Basically, the roadways were patrolled by the motor vehicle department. And so they did most of the motor vehicle investigations and accidents. And that was their real job. For communication in those days, the way communication was handled was the local businesses would have signs that they would put in the window that said, call the local office, call headquarters. And that was how communication was done. And if you really think about that, if you know anything about how law enforcement has evolved, that is really community policing. Well, guess what? Since the 1990s, we've been trying to revert back to community policing. That's how we started, okay? 1935. There was an attempt to establish a state police organization. It was unsuccessful. There was a study that indicated that, yes, we did need this, but we just couldn't get it there. One of our biggest supporters was the Grange. 1937, they introduced a bill, and basically the sheriffs and the local police departments, I'm sorry if I block your view, were able to stay that attempt to develop the law enforcement. They thought they would lose control. They thought they would give up their territory. And I'm by no means berating the sheriffs or the locals, but those struggles go on today. And it's unfortunate because there's plenty of work for everybody out there to do. But it's way better than it was. We basically have a great working relationship with almost every single sheriff's department and local agency. 1946 through the 60s, there was a case in Bennington. 18-year-old college student went for a walk after college classes, took a walk on the Long Trail in Bennington, and disappeared. That case by itself was the catalyst for the state police. And we hold our roots as the state police of Vermont to missing person cases. And I'll talk a little bit in the future about what missing persons mean and what we do with them today as an agency and who's responsible for them. But basically what happened is they had worked this case to exhaustion and they weren't able to get it resolved. There was posters that were put out. They had rewards, $5,000. Think about 1946, what $5,000 would buy. A lot of money. House, yeah. My thought would be probably a house if she was found alive. If she was found dead, if we just found her body, they were going to give $2,000 for her. Okay? Really good solid leads. If you've read if you read the case file and the publications, they did a lot of leads. There were a lot of people who thought they saw her. They ran all those leads down. They chased every little opportunity down. The case was so significant, and oh, by the way, her father, I can't remember, was he an engineer? He was an engineer in Massachusetts. Had a lot of money, had a lot of influence, so he was very helpful and influential in this. Governor Gibson at the time actually brought in the Connecticut State Police and New York State Police and FBI to assist in the investigation. Unfortunately, the case still remains unsolved today. We still work, even cases of this nature, we still work cases of this age today. If we get a lead or a tip, we realize the complications are involved in that. My point is, an unsolved case remains under investigation at all times. Okay? So, this case right here is the catalyst for the Vermont State Police. July 1st, 1947, first graduating class of the State Police. This class consisted of 12 motor vehicle inspectors who were brought over and made troopers, or state police officers, on July 1st. They were all sworn in. This is a graduating picture. The very first commissioner of the Vermont State Police is Major General Merritt Edson. Merritt Edson is a highly, highly decorated World War II veteran. He is a winner of the awarded Congressional Medal of Honor. He actually has a ship in the U.S. Navy named after him. Our uniform to this day resembles the Marine uniform. There's a lot of features about the Marine uniform and the state trooper uniform that are very similar, and they remain intact. Even when our budget has been in very severe straits, they've never considered changing away from this uniform. It's our identity. The other thing that that was part of his doing was the patch. Patch is very significant. If you notice, it has the green mountains in the background, the pine trees. There's a lot of discussion about what the three little buckets on the side are. Those are bales of hay. Now, the one question is, the one thing that nobody's ever been able to answer is, where did we get a blue idea? Not sure. Just an observation. But anyways, you know, this is basically in a logo, this is Vermont. Everything that we talk about and we enjoy about living in Vermont, that's what this is. So, 1947, who are the state police? Well, once it was established, we were authorized with a full strength of 62 people. That's 7 civilians, 55 troopers, 27 officers?
27, correct.
Okay, 27 officers from the highway patrol. 90-hour work week. In the back of the room, just so, because I keep referring to him, is Major Wes Newman. Wes retired as a major from the state police. How many years, Wes?
26 years ago, I had 30 years.
30 years out? And also Sandra Holbrook. Sandra was one of our communications specialists, dispatchers at the time. Okay. These are the people who really, when the department was young, guided the department. So they have they're my resource. So 1947, each trooper was responsible for complete investigations. In many cases today, that is the case. I will tell you, as a state trooper, when I worked the road, I could handle a burglary or an armed robbery from the initial call right through arrest and handing the case over to the prosecutor. So again, we haven't varied too much. In 1947, troopers had one day off a week, no vacation from May 15th through September 15th. Think about that. From 2 weeks from now, you're done. No vacation. I will tell you, and Major Newman could probably attest to this, when I came on, there were enough troopers that were still of that older vintage that on their day off, they would put the phone in the freezer so they couldn't hear it. They did not get Saturdays and Sundays off. Those were traditionally days that you worked. You got a day off during the week and you did work all the holidays. And you did all of this for a whopping $48 a week.
Why didn't they get vacation during those times? What was it? Why was it busier then?
Yeah, it's busier. I'm not sure about the 40s, but in the 60s, I can tell you for a fact, and we'll talk about that in the presentation, in the 60s when the volume came up, that was when all the tours came to Vermont.
We have a new laptop coming, it's just not here yet.
I should have taken Rick up on that.
I lost my train of thought, sorry. This is going to catch up, and we're going to play fast forward. I'll really talk fast. Oh, is there an arrow at the screen on the bottom? Oh, okay. I just can see something white. I can't tell what it says.
Let's start the CASA. Is it working?
No.
Okay. So our first headquarters was Redstone Building in Montpelier. This building still stands. It was recently, up until very recently, the home of the state archives, not state police archives, state archives, meaning that's where all the people that worked to preserve records for the entire state of Vermont worked and kept files. Absolutely beautiful building. Still in existence in there. 1948. We were allowed to purchase 25 Ford sedans, 2 Pontiacs, and 1 Pontiac coupe. Okay? That's a replica, that's our Monte, right? We have a 1947 Ford that we take around. It's identified as Monte. It goes to shows, we take it and drive it in parades, but that's a picture of Monte. I'm sorry?
I think that's actually an original picture.
Oh, that is?
Okay.
So, radios. How did we communicate? So remember, we went from putting a sign in the window, call home, to a radio system. And the first radio system was complete in 1948. It allowed three-way communication, and they were able to actually talk to the cars. I can tell you it's only been probably mid
I want to say mid-90s, that we've had a good radio system. Okay, and I can talk about that a little bit if somebody wants to talk after. 1949, 16 new troopers. help wanted poster. You can't read this, but for example, you had to be 5 feet 10 inches tall, 20/20 vision, weigh 100 and I think that's 60 pounds. Very, very specific. I have troopers that came on right around my time, and they needed glasses. And if they, even at that point, if they had a certain level of vision, they were not on. They couldn't make the cut, even corrected. State police improved their services through public education. Did a lot of community policing. Remember, we talked about that, right? We're out in the public. We're getting our information from the local citizens. And one of the things that they did, they went to the schools and spent time in the schools. And then at the end of the school year, they were involved in serving the hot dogs and ice cream to the students and the parents at the end of the year. I've seen pictures of the troopers up until probably the mid-70s. Our uniform was a full long sleeve shirt, tie, year-round, wool. So you would see the troopers serving the ice cream and the hot dogs at the fairs with their sleeves rolled up because it's 90 degrees. All right, so 4 years. Major Edson survived directing the state police for those 4 years. 1991, he leaves Vermont, goes back, and becomes director of the National Rifle Association. He passed away in 1955. First commissioner is William H. Bauman, selected to become the next commissioner. 31 years old, youngest commissioner in the history of the state, of the United States at the time. Uh, 1954, we get radar. There's an original radar unit in the back corner behind the actual uniform. Let me tell you, you needed a bunch of people to do radar. Most of them just to carry it to the location. Canine unit. So in 1953, we get two bloodhounds. We get a Duchess and Major, part of search and rescue. Again, our roots go back to missing persons. That's what their job was. Bloodhounds were the predominant searching dogs for persons, missing persons. Polygraph. Become the first in 1954, we start using polygraphs. Trooper Glenn Davis becomes the first licensed polygrapher. 115 examinations. To this day, I believe the state police are the only state agency that conducts polygraphed investigations or exams. There are no local police officers conducting polygraph examinations. It's a very arduous task to become an examiner. When they go through the process to do that, I believe there's a 4-page document. They have to memorize that document word for word as part of the examination. Mm-hmm. Very long. We send them to, I believe, Ottawa for training. We also began using color photography. If you think about how, at this time, how expensive that was. When you're out taking pictures at a crime scene, it's not uncommon to take hundreds of pictures and then to come back and develop them in color. Very expensive. New microwave is installed, allowing greater communication. And then as we move forward, we develop in 1957 a Bureau of Criminal Investigation. Don't forget, the troopers still handle that, taking that initial complaint right up through handing the case over to the prosecutor. So in 1957, we start to specialize a little bit. We take some people off the road, we put them in shirts and ties, and they begin to become specialized in the investigation in criminal matters. So the impetus for that is a homicide. Today, the criminal division, or BCI, consists of an arson investigation unit, computer crime unit, special investigations, which does sexual assaults. They do both children and adult
That's their specialty. And then we have the narcotics unit. But again, everybody works together. We could go to a arson investigation, find out that it's also may include a homicide. So the arson investigator will call a homicide investigator in to assist on that investigation. Some changes, 1960. So you asked about the days off, you know, when, geez, May 15th through September 15th, why can't we take time off, or why couldn't we take time off? We start to see a very significant influx in the population and the growth of troopers, okay? And it's because word gets out. I suspect our biggest industry probably at the time was the ski industry. Life magazine and National Life did articles on Stowe, Vermont, and things like that. It really popularized the state of Vermont. So we go to a population of 389,000. We're up to 188 sworn troopers. We have 60 civilian staff. At this time, the interstate system is starting to be built out. 41 miles of interstate. In 1998, we had 320. Miles of interstate. I'm not sure where all these troopers came from. I'm sorry?
It was a presidential visit.
Oh, presidential, okay. So I can tell you right now, that's a picture of the old Colchester office, which is in the fort. There's not that many troopers in the A troop area, which is St. Albans, Williston, and Grand Isle. I don't know. I think that's a whole department right there. So again, all of that activity and that growth starts to bring the people in, and there's lots of traffic, and there's a lot more responsibility. With all of this growth brings more, what? Crime, accidents, things like that. So it causes it makes things for law enforcement a little bit different. Marine Division was created, because we're starting to see activity on the lakes now. Presently, we have 30 boats in our division, including a 26-footer that sits on Lake Champlain. When we talk about 30 boats, you need to understand that some of those boats are like the small little fishing boat that you have at your camp, or that, you know, two people could carry. But we need those small types of boats that we get out on the Green Mountain Reservoir, where they're not allowed to have motors. But we've had situations out there, we need to get out there and either find somebody or look for something. So we have small boats like that as well. We're just giving you time to pause or think about your questions. All right, so 1965, we have our third commissioner. And he's the first commissioner who has risen through the ranks from trooper all the way up through to make commissioner. There have only been two individuals in the entire history of the state police that have made that, and we'll talk about the second one shortly.
I have a question about commissioner. What are the requirements for a person to be commissioner? What kind of background?
It's an appointed position, so it's somebody that the governor has chosen. It's very political. Yeah. Yeah. They spend a lot of time in legislature. They do presentations and respond to daily issues when we're looking at our budget. For example, missing persons. There's legislation right now in place as a result of other activities in the state. How are the state police going to handle this? What are the state police doing about this? He's the point man for that.
So he's more administrative. Doesn't mean necessarily have the police background.
Correct. Correct. Not two commissioners ago, A.J. Walton, Commissioner Walton, was not a police officer. He came in, I believe, from Department of Corrections. Is that correct, Major? He was a we'll call him a politician. Yeah. And he was appointed, and that's their job.
How about Commissioner Flynn?
Commissioner Flynn was a trooper in the early 80s, was a prosecutor in Caledonia County, and then was chosen, appointed from the position of prosecutor to commissioner. Oh, I'm sorry. This is Trooper Alexander. He was actually a motor vehicle inspector in this picture, and that was before he became a trooper.
It's tough. question. Is that an Indian or a Harley?
That's a Harley. I knew that until you asked it, and then you made me think. So we're jumping around a little bit, but back to our history. One of our primary responsibilities is missing persons, and as a result of the missing person situation, we developed a very robust search and rescue team. And I will be honest with you, in preparation of this presentation, I did put out a request to find out some current information about how many people are on the search and rescue team. And I haven't gotten a response back, but I will tell you right now that there is some legislation right now that in addition to being responsible for all missing persons, that the legislature is going to mandate that any agency that does request search and rescue will have to ask for the state police team to come in and assist on that investigation or that search. We're also, this team is also involved in every lost hiker that goes out of bounds when they're skiing. I'm sorry, not hiker, but skier. They're up involved in that to whatever degree they can, and as the situation develops, more and more people and resources are drawn in to help that situation become resolved.
They coordinate?
They coordinate, that's correct. The legislation, though, is actually dictating like who will be involved. Right now, it's predominantly state police search and rescue, but now they want fish and game involved, they want fire departments involved. It's a very good thing, because you draw a lot of beneficial resources from outside, that expertise that we may not have, resources that we may not have access to that they do.
Does the legislation have who pays for it if they wander off the trails?
Yeah, that's it. Well, actually, there is. There's actually, right now, there's the legislation even right now says we can bill that individual back. I just don't know how you collect. The other thing is, as a result of the Paula Jean case, the Commissioner of Public Safety, by statute, is ultimately responsible for every single missing person. So, Milton PD has a missing person right now. Let's just say they have a missing person. If that case, if the prosecutor, the Vermont Attorney General, anybody in that chain thinks that Milton Police is not doing a sufficient job in the investigation, they can direct the Commissioner of Public Safety to take that case over. Now, I will tell you when we get to the end of this, I manage a unit that we do manage every single missing person in the state, and we make phone calls to that police department on those cases. But I can tell you a little bit more about that at the end. So again, search and rescue. All of the members of the search and rescue, like all of our special teams, they do that in addition to their other duties, their day-to-day duties. But they are extremely busy. I can tell you the commander of the search and rescue team, he's a lieutenant. We were at a meeting recently and they were asking him how many phone calls he gets. So he works his 8-to-5 job every day. He said he averages 3 to 5 phone calls a week between 5 p.m. and 8 a.m. on search and rescue calls or requests or questions.
Your dive team's in here too, right?
Yes. So here are some examples. We have some snow recoveries. This is the picture on the right is actually a training mission. They're repelling, snowmobiling. And now, you know, with everything else, technology and advances and everything, we actually have the military that will help us on extractions if necessary. I'm trying to think, we just had a situation a couple weeks ago. I can't remember the details. It was a missing person, and we actually had the Border Patrol up in the air helping us look for that with what they call FLIR system. It's infrared seeking. 1960s. What do we remember about the 60s? Nothing. It's a drug system, right? The drug scene appears. Vermont is not immune. And I can tell you, half of them are still here. Communes, right? So, 60s brought in the drug environment, we had to deal with that. And so the Department of Legislation realized that this was a problem, and they developed a drug unit, And so we had 56 drug investigations in 1968, 1970, 374. Now, what you need to understand about this is, that's the ones they know about. You know, I can tell you, like, complaints that you that people handle, and they don't even know what they have. So, probably a quarter of what they have. 1967, we developed our own drug investigation unit. Undercover officers, long hair, blue jeans, flip-flops. Church Street today.
Yep.
1970, 193 troopers, 85 civilians.
Didn't grow that much.
No. We'll talk a little bit about numbers in a minute. So, six undercover officers, long hair, dirty jeans. And I'm sure if I thought about it, I could figure out who those guys were.
John Lennon.
Who's that? Oh, John Lennon. One of the big things about the 70s is we go online with the federal system. And what that means is we start actually reporting to them. Kind of a pain, but what it means to us, though, is when we start documenting and we need numbers, we have a better system for telling people how many drug complaints do we handle, how many accidents do we handle, that type of stuff, so that when we apply for grants or need money, we now have a better system to achieve that documentation. 1970, E.W. Cochran, appointed commissioner. We also said, up to this point, the lab was manned by troopers, sworn persons, taken off the road, put in the lab, talked to, do the chemical or toxicology. When we started taking those people out of the lab, we started putting those troopers back on the road. What does that mean to you? That means we have more officers out there investigating crime. It's easier to teach a trooper to investigate crime than to be a lab person. I set up and ran our computer crime unit. It was easier for me to bring civilians in who knew how to do computers than it was for me to teach a trooper how to be a techie. Okay. One of the first things we did, mobile crime lab. Up to this point, it was a trooper taking a box out of the back of his car and trying to process the scene by himself. Now we have a mobile crime lab. 1971.
What's the mobile crime lab? What is its capability?
It will contain, like, basically in those days it would contain everything you need to process a scene. Fingerprint kits, photography, cameras, plaster of Paris for making molds, tire impressions, foot impressions, tool marks, things like that. Anything special in that major that you would, on that crane lab? Okay. Vermont Sanatorium. If you've ever been there, very interesting place. They claim it's still haunted. But I thought that was a great place. It hasn't changed much either. Same thing in the 70s, we developed the Vermont Criminal Information Center. That becomes the central point for all documentation and records keeping for criminal information. To this day, that unit still exists. 1976, they utilized their first computer equipment, and the requests went from 40 requests a day, oops, I'm sorry, 40 requests a day, to about, and I know that number's not right, 271,000. That's request for information. That's people looking at local record checks on individuals, requesting photographs, sex offender registry, all that type of information is housed within the
PCS. You get all the different police departments and sheriff's
yes.
departments.
And it can actually be
out of states.
Exactly, it can be out of state as well. Scuba team. Scuba team was developed in the 70s, and they were, they're responsible to this day. They still operate. They can recover evidence. They can recover bodies. That's their primary goal. 1976, I know this sounds a little bit strange, but we hire our first two female troopers. I can tell you as an agency, it has been a struggle. I'm not sure where we're at with females today, but I know when I worked the road and I would go out and do recruiting, it was a struggle to hire female applicants. They weren't interested. 2007, there were 24 female troopers. Basically, this is still somewhat accurate. They hold positions in BCI, Uniform Division, and Support Services. As of 2013, we have troopers in the Computer Crime Unit. There is a trooper, a lieutenant, who runs the Internal Affairs Unit, and they actually function also as canine handlers. Through no fault of their own, the one team that they have tried to get on, it's just too arduous. They do try, it's not, there's no bias in it, is they have not been able to get on the tactical support team and SWAT team. 1977, we developed interstate patrol through federal grants, 55 mile an hour zone. Arson units developed. By the end of the 70s, we have 477,000. So if you remember that last slide, we had about 390. We've grown almost 100,000 in that period of time. 383 registered vehicles, 383,000 registered vehicles, 352,000 licensed drivers. We're up to 259 troopers, 120 civilians. Hey, Captain. When we came on, what do we have? 287 in
270, probably 280, somewhere there.
So put in perspective, somebody mentioned not many numbers. This is 1970s. The captain and I came on in 1987. 287 troopers.
That's when Wes retired.
Yeah. 86.
86.
Late 70s, we had, between 70s and 80s, three commissioners. And although this was before my time, you can imagine that this creates a sense of instability. We've actually recently had a situation of a couple of colonels in the state police. I can tell you, it does create a sense of instability. You don't think so, but it does, because they each come in, they each have their own mission, they have their own plan. This must have been a very difficult time. Commissioner Philbrook is appointed in the 80s. 1984, we get Charles Bristow. And then in 1986, I think I all messed up. We get Commissioner Walton. I mentioned him earlier. He was from Department of Corrections. And then Commissioner Sleeper was appointed. He is the second one trooper who went from trooper through the ranks to the point of colonel. January 2008, Tom Trombley was our commissioner. He was a deputy chief in Burlington Police Department, or maybe the chief. And then when Governor Shumlin took office, he appointed Keith Flynn. And that's where we are today with commissioners. 1983, headquarters moves from Montpelier to Waterbury. This is our picture of the existing building, and there's now a whole brand new state-of-the-art forensic crime lab off of this end that you can't see.
Did you get flooded out?
No. No. And I'm surprised, but we didn't. But the other end of that complex, that's a big state complex, they did. 1987, we took over control of grant funds for drugs. As a result of that grant funding, we developed a statewide task force. That task force is still in operation today. Initially, it used to be called SIU, Special Investigative Unit. It's now known as the Narcotic Investigative Unit. It still exists today, has multiple members of various agencies throughout the state. One of the benefits that the agencies that supply officers to that investigative unit, when they do drug cases, they're involved in the drug case, any seizure that is a result of a criminal investigation, that agency gets a portion of the proceeds that are obtained through forfeiture. Changes in technology in the early 90s helped us to improve our operating system. Some of the things that were done, we reduced the number of trooper positions, made them sworn. We took units that used to be manned by state police personnel, put those people back in the field and put civilians in their place. One of those is the Criminal Justice Service Division. That unit now manages all of our radios, our communications, things like that, our IT section. And then the other thing that that was managed at that time was Criminal Information Center. We mentioned that earlier. They were automated, again, so that we could get better processing. Some of the other things that took place in the 90s, this sounds funny, but when I came on the job, right up until the mid-90s, we would still process a drunk in the car. And if anybody knows what I'm talking about, we had what were called crimpers. They were wooden boxes. You plugged them into your cigarette lighter. They had a special tube that was in place. The tube heated up. You took the breath sample, you crimped it. They were called crimpers. We'd send that tube to the lab, and they would process the contents of the tube. In the 90s, we went to an infrared machine. That's big. That was big technology. So not only did I have to was not able to do it in my car anymore, I had to drive it back to the office. You talk to the young troopers today, and they're out of their mind. You process a drunk in your car, and when they want to call an attorney, you use the payphone. Yes, we did. That's how we live. Forensic Crime Lab was able to establish DNA analysis. And then we went to a statewide computer system, a CAD system. As a result of that, up until recently, all law enforcement, all state and local law enforcement, was on one system with the exception of three police departments. And that meant when Mark Lauer got stopped on the side of the road by Milton Police Department, and they entered that at the time, the minute they hit enter, Brattleboro Police Department could look up Mark Lauer and see that he was involved in a car stop. Now, some agencies are moving away. There's about six agencies that are not on that system, but we all still share information. We can look at each other's databases anyways. Some other things that took place. We consolidated some offices, reorganized some troop areas, and developed PSAPs, public safety answering points. What this meant is that your St. Albans office still exists, but the dispatch for calls and the phone calls that came in were no longer handled at that point. They were moved to the Williston office. And so there was one big communication center. And we developed four of them around the state. And we realigned the troop areas to fit those needs. Okay? That was also the implementation of 911, statewide 911. That's not on, but So we're moved into four divisions. We have state police, we have Vermont Emergency Management, Criminal Justice Services, and Fire Safety, all under one umbrella, Department of Public Safety. Through those times, every time we have a new colonel that comes in, just so you understand, they take a look at the department, they reevaluate a number of issues, and some of the things that they do is they look at our core values. And these are the current core values of Vermont State Police. You're expected to have courage, you're expected to be honest, and you're expected to operate with integrity. And I can tell you that as an agency, we really do stand by those things. If you fail in any one of those areas, you won't be with us long. Some special teams. Let's talk about special teams. We have a variety of special teams that are created to better serve the community. Members of these special teams do these jobs in addition to their day-to-day operation. So I can tell you from experience, I was a canine handler for 6 years. I was also on the SWAT team for 6 years. You did those jobs in addition to your day-to-day job. I will tell you, it wasn't expected, but basically, if I was out until 3, 4 in the morning on a canine call or on a SWAT call, I still went to work the next morning or the next shift whenever it started. That's the expectation. We have a bomb squad. Their job is respond, evaluate, dismantle, and hopefully preserve any possible evidence in a situation that involves explosive. We have hostage negotiation team. Very clear, and very simple. Resolve the conflict verbally if they can. Critical incident dispatch team. These critical incident dispatch teams are dispatched with the hostage negotiation team, if appropriate, with the bomb squad, or any situation where we need to take the responsibility of answering the phone calls off of that local office. And the critical incident team will come up, set up a command post, and the local incident will be handled through that critical incident response team.
How do you train your personnel for these different responsibilities? Do you bring people in from FBI or other organizations?
To be selected for a special team, you have to have 2 years good standing on the job, meaning you cannot come on and in 6 months be placed on a special team. When you go through the process, they will put out an announcement that we have one opening or two openings. You then go through an interview process with the commander of that special team and selected other individuals. And then you are then, if you're selected, you will go to whatever training is appropriate for that. So for like the bomb squad team, they go to Alabama, where there's a nationally recognized bomb squad, bomb training area. In addition to that, you do work with all the other bomb techs in the area. You might work with FBI bomb techs, you work with TSA, Transportation Security Agency, things like that. And that goes with all of them. Scuba team, for example, we have our own in-house dive masters. They can conduct the training for our people. All of our special teams, every single one of them, works with any other special team in the state or regionally. We also have what's called NESPAC, New England State Police Association. And what will happen is we will actually go to train with, for example, Maine State Police with their tactical support team.
What do you take? Let's take the scenario of having a marathon here and the problem that happened in Boston. Who takes the lead on establishing the protocol and the organization and the leadership?
Well, right now, we're having meetings with Burlington PD to discuss that. And just as they did in Boston, Burlington PD will be the lead investigator until they decide to relinquish control. But I would suspect that based on the situation, if they relinquish control, it's going to be to the FBI. And part of that is going to be dictated on the nature of the event. So when you have a bomb blast, something like that, it's going to be terrorism, FBI is going to take it over. But I can tell you that through experience, like what we did, for example, we were involved in the fish concerts, all three of them. Those were in state police territory. So we handled them, we involved the locals and the sheriffs, but they were our responsibility. Search and rescue team, you know, they do ground-based searches. They have become very high-tech. They have some great equipment. They have GPS units, they have four-wheelers, they have all kinds of great stuff. Plus, again, they work with all our partners. Canine teams, went from being strictly a protection unit, which was my dog. I had a dog, he was not drug trained, he was strictly protection and seeking lost persons. They now do drug work, they do bomb work, and they do cadaver work as well. Crash reconstruction, these people involved in all serious motor vehicle accidents or fatalities situations involving large tractor trailers, they will come out and do reconstruction for us. Honor Guard represents the Vermont State Police at all law enforcement or dignitary-related funerals or events. If we have a presidential visit or a high dignitary, we can be requested to be present at that with our honor guard. Technical support unit, more commonly known as the SWAT team. Critical situations, do search warrants, high-risk search warrants, resolve high-risk situations.
What does SWAT stand for?
Special Weapons and Tactics. Okay, you guys are getting a headache after this. So, again, just touching on the fact that these jobs are handled by troopers that are doing this in addition to their regular duty. And we've changed, as time has gone on, we found some things that worked, and we're experimenting with other things to see what works better. One of the things that we're learning as a result of, for example, the search and rescue off trooper who's getting multiple phone calls at night, we've changed the way we do things so that there's somebody on call now. Like, for example, a couple weeks ago, I was on call for a night shift. I actually worked 4 p.m. until 1 a.m. I didn't even know I had a headlight switch in my car up until that point. And my night driving is terrible. So just beware. Criminal division.
We'll let you lead first, though.
What's that?
We'll let you lead first.
Absolutely. I encourage that. That and the 3 cups of coffee I've had, I'll be all set. So the criminal division is, to be put in some of these positions, we recognize the benefit and the value of a uniformed trooper. They are the backbone. They're the front line. They're the people that you encounter every day. Criminal division is a division of people who have become selected due to some of their talents and their techniques. And they're basically your shirt and tie individuals. You'll see them. They'll come to the major crime scenes. When you see a law enforcement agency being interviewed on TV at a homicide, shirt and tie individuals, those are criminal division. They're detective sergeants or detectives that have specialized training in criminal investigation. Part of the criminal division is also the unit that I run, which is Vermont Information Analysis Center. It's basically an intel unit. And we're involved in, and we support the criminal division as well as the local troopers, but that's really what we do. We talked about this a little bit. Criminal division is BCI, criminal division, and as well as special investigation unit. That's the sex crime unit. We talked about this, fire investigation, they do arson. Support services division is that. This is kind of a unique division that's developed out of time. This division contains Homeland Security, Fleet Service. Fleet Service is the division that manages and maintains all of the state police cars, as well as some others, but also actually all of the Department of Public Safety cars. Let's be clear about that. They're also the Office of Professional Development. That's our training academy. Office of Technology Management is IT. Computers. And then we also have our public information officer in there. And this unit also is responsible for working on what we call capital projects. And what that is for example, this unit managed the development and the building of the St. Albans State Police Office when it moved from over near the hospital out onto Fisher Pond Road, which is where the Vermont State Archives is, which we'll talk about in a minute. Homeland Security Unit consists of a captain. He's the Homeland Security Advisor. He briefs the governor. So for example, the Boston bombing, you know, as we sit here in Vermont, you think about that and you're like, well, what does that have to do with us? Well, the question about the Burlington Marathon, it has a lot to do with us. So the Homeland Security Advisor is briefing the Colonel of the State Police, the Commissioner of the State Police, and the Governor as to what is happening and how it's affecting Vermont or could affect Vermont. What does that mean? That's his job. That captain is my boss. It's my job to feed him all of that information. So through that Boston bombing incident, I was working with Boston through my unit getting quarterly, half-hour updates from them, exactly what was going on. That's what our Homeland Security does. Homeland Security is also responsible for administering federal grants that have any nexus that can support terrorism investigations and terrorism activities, exercises, planning, missions, et cetera, et cetera. So this unit is very much involved in the preparation of the Burlington Marathon that's coming up. We're working with Burlington PD on how we're going to prepare for this. What are we going to do? What do we need? What resources do you want? That's what we're doing. Officer professional development, very short. They are the training academy. They are the recruiters. Those are the people that are going out to the schools. They're providing the test, the entrance exams for state troopers to take. That's their job. They're also responsible for maintaining our training as troopers. Every year, law enforcement officers in the state of Vermont have to have a minimum number of hours of training. And of that, those minimum numbers, there's very specific items that we have to take training on annually. And so that's their job to make sure that we do that and provide it to us. Office of Technology Service, they're basically the people that maintain our IT support. They're responsible for all of the vehicles that have in-car cameras. All of our cruisers, or the majority of our marked cruisers, have computers on board, mobile data units. And they also are responsible for the implementation of license plate readers. Fleet services, we talked about that. If we didn't have these guys, our cars wouldn't roll. And, you know, there's been times when they've been able to keep our cars going with duct tape and fishing line. Recreational enforcement, we talked about them. They run all of the boats and the snowmobiles. That's their job. They're involved in all the enforcement, but they're also involved in supporting the search and rescue mission. So if we have an overturned boat out on Lake Champlain, the dive team is not going to get out there without them. The search and rescue team is not going to get out there without them. So that's recreational enforcement. Unfortunately, while I was preparing this presentation, this is... Harold Ace Ackerman. Ace was one of the original troopers. He was the last surviving trooper. He just died on April 15th. He has done numerous interviews, for example, with VPR, NPR. He was a very comical individual. He was green and gold to the day he died. He would show up. They do retirement breakfast every other Thursday, and anyone that he could make, he generally made. He's a very interesting individual. One of the points we want to make, you know, as an agency, we have not lost that many troopers. These are the four troopers that have died in the line of service since 1947. What I want to touch on right now is this presentation was brought to you as a result of Vermont State Archives, State Police Archives and Museum. And all of the documentation that was put into this presentation as a result of the collections and the hoarding of products and information. So one of the things that they do is as a board member, we are always looking for any information or items or products or documentation. We would love to get anything that you have. As was mentioned earlier, we are a nonprofit. We'll definitely take your donations. You can write them off. But on the other hand, too, is one of the things that we will do, if you have something that you would like to donate to us for display, we will be happy to display it and give it back to you. If it's a photograph, for example, all those photographs on that easel right now, for example, if you have some photographs that you don't want to give up but you'd be willing to share with us, we can make copies of them and give you the original back. But we are looking for anything. We will take anything. Sandy is the original hoarder. I'm not sure what her house looks like, but given what she's collected, it's a good thing. These are just some miscellaneous photos that when I asked for some information that I was given. I'm not sure who this is, Wes. This just said Cummings?
I'm not sure. I think your names are Powell. I think they're down either in Windham or Lennox County. That's probably where the local police department will be at.
Okay. Again, this is a Grateful Dead concert in Highgate back in the mid-90s. Kind of a like a little dichotomy. 60s bus, new trooper. One of the things that's very interesting, for a period of time, and I don't know what the exact period was, we actually had a mounted patrol. The topic of a mounted patrol is a little bit of a thorn. When I was, I'm trying to think about this, 1994, I think there was a court ruling that caused the department to have to pay canine handlers 30 minutes of overtime for being a canine handler, because we have to feed and groom the dogs and stuff like that. So it was a court ruling. The state didn't have a choice. They had to pay us. So as a result, they cut the canine unit in half. At the same time, now keep in mind, those canine units are out searching for missing persons, protecting officers. At the same time, they were talking about reintroducing the mounted patrol. How much does it cost to maintain a horse? this is a motor vehicle inspector. Notice the motorcycle and uniform. It's very similar to the uniform in the back of the room. Difference is he's wearing breeches on that. We have it's a full uniform in the back. Anybody know who this is? Yeah, he was, I forget what the story is on this, Wes. He was visiting Vermont. Making a movie.
The Temple with Harry.
Is that what it was?
Yeah. Craft Spirit.
I thought it was going to be Black Flies, but they changed it to Birds. here's our contact information. I realize nobody has anything to write with, because who comes to a presentation with anything to write with? But you can find us. We do have a website, VSP Archives. There is an email address, and we are located in St. Albans. You're welcome to, all you have to do is call the local St. Albans office if you ever want to stop by, and Wes or Sandy will make arrangements to share with you, collect anything you want to donate to us, etc. And that concludes my presentation. If you have any questions about state police, anybody have anything?
I just want to make a comment about the mounted patrol. They were all volunteers. They paid their own way. They helped use their own trailers. So there wasn't any overtime or any money at all.
They were troopers, though, right?
No, they weren't.
No?
The auxiliaries.
Auxiliaries, okay. I was going to ask that. Yeah.
You were mentioning earlier the difficulty of getting a good radio system. Does that do a lot of just the terrain of the state?
A combination of terrain and finances. When I came on, I can talk to you about me. 1987, I came on the department. We had these four-channel Motroc radios, which we probably got in the 70s, Wes?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
They were donated to us by Boston PD. Now, put this in perspective. We have a terrain issue. There's four channels for the entire state. There were areas, I worked actually St. Albans, Lamoille County, back to St. Albans in a short period of time in Williston. In an effort to save money, when Boston PD donated them, these radios had crystals in them. So you didn't just pull a crystal out and replace it. So they left the radios with the Boston channel in it. And on beautiful summer days like this, we would get what was called skip. Boston PD would be talking on their channel, and in St. Albans, it was blowing us out of the cars. You asked about terrain. It was not uncommon. Now again, these channels didn't scan. You had to roll to that channel that you needed. If you were in the wrong area, like what we call the shadow of the tower, your radio may not get out. I had a situation with my canine. I chased an individual through North Cambridge, Vermont, and we had zero radio communication, and I was literally just talking on the radio because they couldn't hear me. And by luck, I had a deputy sheriff who picked it up, could hear it, and was trying to track me based on my radio calls. We got a really bad fight. My dog bit this individual at the time. This was probably 1990, three. He bit this individual worse than we'd ever had a dog, as for a dog bite in the state of Vermont. And if it wasn't for that deputy sheriff coming to help me, it would have ended very badly. So the radio situation was bad. After the Carl Draga affair, mid-90s, everybody remember this? This is an individual who, very disgruntled with state government in New Hampshire. He, I forget the sequence, but he basically went in and shot a court judge, a editor of a newspaper, and eventually shot a fish and game warden in New Hampshire, crossed the border into Vermont, and then we got into a shootout with him in Vermont. He ended up dying. As a result of that, we used federal funds. We significantly upgraded our radio system, and ever since then, we've been able to continuously upgrade our radio system now to the fact it's all digital now.
And you see the evolution of arms, guns, with the bad guys from time. I mean, even before your time, back to Wes's time. I mean, you must have, these bad guys have more and more arms. I mean, it must really affect your mind.
You know, yes, it does. It doesn't. When I came on in 1987, so from 87 till about early 90s, we still had 357 handguns, revolvers. Early 90s, we went to 9mm, 6-hour 9mm. One of the problems that we had, though, with the 9mm is they did not have knockdown power. We had numerous shootings involving troopers, and the bad guys were dying. I know it's a bad way to put it, but we had to resolve that because they were still fighting back. So, yes, but they're always going to be one step ahead of us. They don't have rules, we do. Tasers, you know, I will tell you, I know there's a lot of talk about tasers, good and bad. I have to tell you, you know, until you're in a situation with somebody that's 6'4" and you're fighting with them and you have no backup, that taser is going to save your life. And I know there's some bad situations that have happened, but you know, if you think about that one individual in that situation, like how long do you need your public servant to be out of service and hurt, and maybe hurt for a lifetime, for that to be a proper...
Better than a gun.
That's right. Any other questions?
Do they have public hours for the archives if people want to come visit them?
8 to 12, Monday and Wednesday.
8 to 12, Monday
and Wednesday.
Or by appointment. Yes. Any other questions? I appreciate your time.
We'd love for you to join us for refreshments in the meeting room. And also, please take some time to look at all of the archives and pictures and such that have been placed around the room.